Now, before discussing anything more about this simple harmonic oscillator, let us look at the nature of this potential energy. So, we said that U is equal to half kx square. Right. What I can do is I can plot this. So, let's say this is my x, this is my U. I can plot this, and at least here I can see that x is 0, U will be 0, and then x other than 0 on either side, because this is a linear coordinate, so it will have extend from 0 to minus infinity to plus infinity. This is going to go something like this, right? And which is basically a shape of a parabola, which is the equation of parabola. So the potential energy looks something like this. U of x is like this. Of course, the total energy E is a constant. So again, it depends on the nature of the force and all that. However, so U as a function of x goes like this. As you keep going away from the origin, in this case origin, it could be any other reference point also. As we keep moving away from the origin, the potential energy keeps increasing. Right? The system stores more and more and more energy, or requires more and more energy to go farther. However, for a system oscillating under the center force, we know that total energy is constant, right? Which is again given by the initial conditions or the maximum amplitude of the system. So in this scale, right, this is arbitrary scale, in this scale, I may have that this is my total energy, right? So at this point is the total energy, right? And now this is called, so a plot of U of x or r, doesn't matter, versus x is called energy diagram. I'm just a term given to it, right? And what one can do is one can see certain problem system looking at the energy diagram. For example, the potential energy varies like this. Total energy of the system is here, right? And we know that for this system, E is k plus u, which implies the kinetic energy at any given point in space is going to be simply total energy minus what is the potential energy there. We know total energy, it's a constant, we know how the potential energy changes. So at any given point, let's say this location, if somebody asks you what is the, let's say x1, what is the potential energy? Potential energy U of x1 is U1, right? This is U1. What is the kinetic energy? It's E minus U1. So K1 is this. If I move to another point, x of 2, potential energy is U2, kinetic energy is K2. And one can see that as the potential energy of the system decreases, the kinetic energy increases. At its minimum, the potential energy will be minimum, kinetic energy will be maximum, some product of kinetic potential will be equal to total energy, always this line. Again, as the U increases, kinetic energy will keep on decreasing. So for example, at this point, let's say x3, U3, and then the kinetic energy is only this much. K3, right? So this is the energy diagram for the system. Okay. In classical mechanics, because you will encounter later on, or you may have already known about the effects of quantum nature of the systems. However, in classical mechanics, these points, so on the potential energy curve, the point where the potential energy exceeds the total energy of the system, these are called classical turning points, or basically these correspond to the maximum amplitude of the system, because we know that the total energy of the system is directly related to the maximum amplitude. So once the system has this energy, it doesn't have any more energy, so it cannot climb further on the potential energy ladder, and then it will basically make a turn towards the center of the force, right? So these are called the classical turning points of the system. And now, looking at this behavior, what we can do is, so let us say I have a general, so let's say I don't know what is the nature of the force, I have a general potential energy function U of R, right? And all that we know is motion of the system is bound. So we are not saying that the potential energy function is like half kx square or kr square. All we are saying is we have a general potential energy function U of R in which motion of the system is bound. That means for whatever reason there are these turning points and there is a fixed total energy of the system, and the system is oscillating between these two extremes, right, around some central location. Okay, so this is the case that now, as long as U of R is a continuous differentiable function, right? So it's a proper function. There are no discontinuities. There are no aberrant behaviors of the system. If it's a continuous differentiable function, then one knows that for any function of this kind, we can expand this function about a reference point. So let's say U of R as U of R0. So it's a Taylor expansion, right? Can be written in Taylor series. Right? You can expand this kind of function into Taylor series. So if U of R is a continuous differential function, then you can expand this over, let's say, point R0, right? In this case, that would have been the origin, R0. Then here R minus R0 du over dr at R equal to R0 plus, and of course there are several terms here, R0 square d2u over dr square R equal to R0. Okay, we can write down plus R minus R0 whole cube d cube u over dr cube R equal to R0 plus like that, right? So we can have several partition there, it will extend to infinity. So this is the Taylor series. We can write, so now this is a general function, right? It's independent of all this analysis. Now I'm not talking about this particular one. For a general potential energy function, we can write it down like this, right? And now since we have said that the system is bound, right? So that means the system goes up to some extreme, comes back, and we know that when the system is bound, that means there must be a center location which is kind of pulling it. So that would mean that there is a change in potential energy, and let us say that the potential energy is maximum at that point. So this R0 is that point. We are expanding the function around that point R0. So we say that U of R0 is a minima, or you have the minimum value when measured at R0. What this means is du of dr at R0 is going to be equal to 0. We know how to find axioms of a function. So if there is a minimum or maximum of a function, then at that point the slope is 0. So d over dr is 0. Right? And if that is the case, then now I can write down this equation as u of r is u of r0 plus, if this condition is true, then this term will be simply equal to 0, right, for the motion to be bound. So the next term, r minus r0 whole square d2u over dr square r equal to r0 plus higher order term, this cube term, then 4 power and r, right? Now again, if R is, well, we'll call it mod of R is close to R0, because I'm writing mod of R, although R in this sense, when we say it's a real coordinate, it only goes from 0 to infinity, right? However, right now I'm using it interchangeably to define either the real coordinate or could be a dimensional coordinate in XYZ system. So that's why I have written mod of r. So if this is very, very close to r0, if the motion is not too far away from r0 for any arbitrary function, right? Of course, this thing will be exactly true for this kind of function, because then it doesn't matter how long is the amplitude. For any general potentiality function, as long as the motion is not too far from the minimum of the potential energy, right, or this central point, in that case, what will happen is, as we expand the series, r minus r0 term will be very, very small. So this implies that r minus r0 is much, much less than 1. Right? So then what will happen is, that solving this, the second power, third power, fourth power, those values will be very, very small. Right? So in that case, when we try to look at the effect of the series, we can simply truncate it at the second power and forget about the rest. And if we do that, if we can write down our potential energy in that form, then what it basically gives us is u of r for any general potential, right? So this is a general potential now. This is not coming from minus kx4 or minus kr4. U of r, it just have to be continuously differentiable function. U of r is then u of r0, which is again a constant value, that's an additive constant, will not affect nature of or behavior of the energy function, right? It's just an additive constant. R minus r0 square d2u over dr square, r equal to r0, and rest of our terms are truncated, right? Okay, so this becomes our general expression for a potential energy function, right? As long as it satisfies the property that we have discussed. If this is the general additive constant, I can normally also drop it, right? It's just going to shift my, or I can take it on this side, it's going to shift my reference point. So we can also, so we can write down u of r as r minus r0 square d2u dr square r equal to r0. And now compare this with our u of x half k x square. Sorry, there is a, when you do a Taylor series expansion, there is a factor of half here, and then 1 by 3 factorial in the next order term and all that. So just check that the Taylor expansion series is fine. There is a factor of half here. So anyway, so half r minus r0 square d2u over dr square r equal to r0. It's very similar in form. So for a general potential, right, general potential which is a proper function, which is a proper function form, sorry, is, does look rather similar to this simple harmonic potential, right, coming from the central force of minus kx, right? Again, where in the region which is very, very close to this minimum of the potential energy. So near that region, the nature of the potential can be treated as this parabolic form, or the potential corresponding to the simple harmonic oscillator. And what that tells us is, if we are looking for motion not very large in amplitude around the potential minima, then for any bound system, we can simply approximate that bound system with a simple harmonic oscillator, right? And then of course, for the we know the solution for simple harmonic oscillator, so we can apply that to any bound system, right? And in fact, that is what is used mostly. And what we can also get from here is, then the k, or the characteristic spin constant, which is seen there, the k, or once we find the k, we can also find the natural frequency, is basically equal to, near that potential energy minimum, is equal to dr over dt of r0. So the characteristic force constant for any force which has a potential energy form like this, near the minimum of that potential energy, or for oscillations or for motion confined near the potential energy minimum, is basically the second derivative of the potential energy itself at that location, at the minima of potential energy function, right? And once you get this, you divide by m and you can get the characteristic frequency. So basically, we can find out then omega naught for any general system. Okay. So this is a very important result. And now what we'll do is we'll take a quick example and try to see that can we find out the omega naught for a general system. So let us say, what is my example? Yeah. So let us say in one dimension, I have a potential which looks something like this. And actually this is a potential which is which will be encountered later. But anyway, for time being, we'll just write it E over x square minus V over x. Okay? This is a potential. It's a continuous differential potential. So we know that we can expand it into a Taylor series. And for motion near that potential energy minimum, we can approximate it as a harmonic oscillator. But before going there, let's find out what kind of shape this potential has, right? So let us try to do that. And let us see. This is my x coordinate. This is my u of x, right? And now you can see that u of x could be positive or negative depending on what are the values of a and b. So I have put it like this. This is my 0. Now, one part in u of x is a over x square. So it goes as, for whatever constant a, as long as a and b are positive. So let's say a and b are greater than 0. So in that case, this goes as 1 over x square. Right? And 1 over x square function will look something like this. Okay. It will extend up to infinity. At infinity, it will approach 0. Right? This is minus 1 over x because b is positive. This is minus 1 over x. Minus 1 over x will again, basically, at infinity, this is going to be 0. And at 0, this is going to be negative maximum. So this will actually go like this. However, the slope or the rate at which this changes is different from the rate at which this changes. So this goes to infinity much faster compared to this when x is near 0. And this also goes to 0 much faster compared to this, right? So on this side, this one is dominating. On this side, this one is dominating, okay? And if that is the case, then sum product of this looks something like this. At system close to 0, the 1 over x square dominates, right? Somewhere, and then for farther away, 1 over x dominates. So this will have 1 over x square kind of behavior. On the tail end, this will have minus 1 over x kind of behavior. So this is the form of this potential, given whatever the a and b, as long as they are positive. And you can see that there is this region, right? All this region, which looks rather similar to our superharmonic oscillator, and basically the motion will be bound. For example, if the total energy is here, then this is the amplitude, this is the amplitude, and the motion will be simply bound here because this is in the u minimum. Right? Okay, so all we have to do is now with the problem, let's say this is x naught, so we have to find out what is x naught, and then what is near x naught if the particle is making a motion or system making a motion. Then how it is going to, what is the Kekulean frequency for that, right? So now we can find out x naught. So for that, we know that u prime of x, which is du over dx, right, is equal to 0 at x equal to x naught. So that will be then minus 2a over x cube plus b over x square is equal to, and x naught here is equal to 0. So we can find out x naught from here, right? And this will give us x naught equal to 2a by b. Please confirm. With this x naught, now I can find out my k. My k is simply double derivative of this at x equal to x naught. So another derivative, 6a over x naught 4 minus 2b over x naught cube, right? This is the k at x naught. We can put the value of x naught here, 2a by b, and what I get is b 4 over 8a cube, b is to 4 over 8a cube. So this is the value of k, and if this is the value of k, then what is omega naught? Omega naught is basically the square root k by m. So b4 over 8ma cube. So knowing these values of a and b, we can find out without actually solving for the equation of motion of the system, just by showing that near x naught the motion is simple harmonic in nature, we can find the characteristic frequency of oscillation if we know these constants a and b for the system. Okay. So for time being, what I'll suggest is you go over this analysis, understand it, and then keep this in mind, because later on we will fall back on the same problem and see that our results actually make sense. Okay.